pursued, even screaming for you to show. Can you just talk about what that felt like to hear that and to see that in the video?
It was very touching. And I didn't even hear him. Had I heard him, I would have gotten somebody to take me outside. But maybe it's a good thing I didn't go outside. Because I'd have been in jail with, along with him.
I know that's right.
Yeah.
The country, and it's happening in our backyard, and I can't sit around silent when it's happening in my backyard. Can't do it. It's wrong. No.
Mark, the cops is beating this man out here on his ground, but I'm recording everything.
Come here.
Right here.
Oh, shit. Oh, shit.
Look! How many times they beating him? Look! He down. Look how many times they beating him. Listen! Tase the motherfucker! Listen! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 cops on one man.
He been right here tough.
Look. He calling his grandma, so he live around here somewhere. He said, Grandma, come to the door. Tase him again, kicking him, punching him. Look.
No, don't do it. Again?
12 cops.
Right.
12 cops.
One motherfucker.
12 cops.
Oh, white motherfuckers. One, two.
It's the whole department now.
Right.
The whole department. It's the whole department now. Piece of shit. He was riding a bike and they stopped him on the bike.
Okay, yeah. I wanted to. Damn.
He's saying I'm sorry. The man is saying I'm sorry.
Wow. Tase this motherfucker.
Tase him 4 or 5 times. Beat him, kick him.
Look how many cops out there. Right there.
Mm-hmm.
On one dude?
One dude. It's only one. You couldn't. He couldn't get up when the four was on him.
Wow.
The four jumped out this white car right here. The four jumped out the white car. He was riding the bike, and they caught him right here, and then they just started beating him. And then all the other cops came up and just started beating
right.
him.
And just jumped on the scene.
Yeah. He wasn't going nowhere. Four cops had him. He wasn't
one
going
dude,
nowhere.
One man.
One man. And he still got up and walked away. Thank God he lives right now. We don't know what he's gonna do when he get him back to the wherever they're gonna take him.
Wow, look, cause they've been riding around for the past couple of days. They hype.
Yeah, they want another one. They want to lynch another nigga now.
It's crazy. It's all white cops. Hey, where the black cops at?
It's two.
It's two over here?
It's two. Mm. It's 24 whites and 2 blacks.
Wow.
But it doesn't matter. They all on the same team.
Right. It ain't that serious. Like,
look, that's the bike he was riding. And he jumped. Oh, he threw away the bike.
I threw it on the side.
Yeah, I hope that wasn't Anthony. Wow. So how many cop cars is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 cop cars.
How many cops are there? That's some real shit right there.
That's the first four, first wow. Nice day.
Everybody.
Shut it down! Shut it down!
Burn it down!
We ain't about to keep this visible because the visibility of police abuse in the African American community has been exposed now. Not only here, but all over the country. And Tyree Carroll is one example of many this whole thing is about. It's about the police policing themselves and start arresting individuals that violate human rights. And hopefully, with this case, in this town, that we will set an example. We have the police commissioner in Philadelphia, Commissioner Ramsey. And we hope that he acts accordingly and that there'll be some disciplinary action taken toward those police officers that are involved in this. No one can point anywhere in this country where a police manual says you get out of a car, unprovoked, and start kicking. That is not policing. That is, abuse.
Yes.
That's something that's been going on far too long.
Yes.
Not only in Philadelphia, but all over this country. So Philadelphia joins the rest of the country and those progressive people that say it's time to end this.
Yes.
And that we're not going back to that. We're not going backwards, going to go forward. And there's a lot of people that don't believe the same way I believe, and the lawyers involved in this case, and my client believes that police force has to be appropriate. There's nothing, and let's not clarify, there's been some allegations of drugs. Let's not be distracted from what's here. The real issue is police brutality.
Absolutely.
Black people being considered human beings.
That's right.
Hispanics being considered yes. human beings. Everybody yes. being considered human beings, and that's what this is all about. So we look forward to our day in court, where I think my client will be vindicated in terms of what did he do? Now, what do they do? Most of the time, these cases, what has the person done? Nothing.
Guilty of being black.
That's it.
That's correct.
That's
guilty of being Hispanic, black. And in this city, just being guilty in the wrong place at the wrong time, because there are many allegations from the white community about police abuse. So we asked the commissioner to open his eyes and look at it, look at the video. Look at the kicking and then repeated punches. And that's what this is all about.
Why do you think the commissioner has not responded yet?
Well, I think I'm hoping that it's because he's still investigating. You know, they take each of these actions and they look at the video frame by frame. I'm hoping that he's really doing an in-depth investigation. That's what I'm hoping. You understand what I'm saying? So that's all we can hope for. So again, I'm just a small piece in this enormous wheel that we have that's rolling right now, but I appreciate the courage of the Carroll family, and we just got to continue to fight for what's right. Thank you very much.
What do you want to see happen for your client and for these?
Well, I'd like to see my client obviously exonerated in court, but I think also punished. That's what should happen.
What he's telling is that he's pulled over for a drug bust, and obviously the counter narrative is that he's pulled over going the wrong way down a street. So I mean, the police said they recovered 5 grams of crack cocaine. I mean, do you believe that was planted? Is there any truth to that at all?
Obviously, I can't discuss what my client has told me so far, although he hasn't told me much because I'm new to the case. But the Commonwealth has a burden to prove that he possessed that. I think when you look and when we air the full number of events, that are full versions of events that the police contend happened, you sort of get the feeling, and I've gotten that feeling looking at the paperwork, that they basically rousted this young man for no good reason. They don't have a reason that is, in my view, presents them with ample cause to have stopped him in the first place.
Right.
The beating ensued, the injuries ensued. I assume they knew they had a video at some point, and I don't think it takes a huge leap to believe that the police may have been trying to protect themselves once they realized that
of course
was an unwitnessed event. Exactly.
Of course. Exactly. And if he had crack or not, he didn't deserve to get a whooping like
that. That's what I'm saying. It doesn't matter what you are doing in life. Are an unarmed person. Nobody should be called to force by people like that.
So, of course, we think it is wrong to beat any of our children. Children should not be beaten like this, and certainly not by police officers who are supposed to be protecting them.
Yes.
You know, let's remember, the question here isn't, were they justified in retaliating against Tyree? They're not supposed to retaliate, beat people up because
right.
they're mad at
them. Right.
Was this excessive force? So
absolutely.
Even under the police officer's story, which we have to question, it's excessive for multiple police officers to beat and kick and threaten and curse somebody who is prone on the ground.
Not fighting.
Not fighting.
At all.
What is the justification for that? I think under any of these scenarios, it was excessive. It was excessive force. And we want to get to the bottom of what really happened and get justice for Tyree. He should not be in jail. Look at the video. Who is guilty of assault?
The police.
Who is guilty of assault?
The police.
Why is he in jail? Why is he in jail? And nobody else is even held accountable for this at this point. So, exactly. So that's what we're calling for, justice for Tyree. And please join us tomorrow for the march and rally as we continue to demand justice for this young man who was brutally beaten by the Philadelphia police. Thank you.
What else do you want to do if you have your innocent? Yes. What else do you want to do as an individual, one person, riding a bike and then you know the history of these Philadelphia police
yes.
officers?
Yes.
Not only just Philadelphia, around the world, like their whole cult. When they jump out on you and you know you did nothing wrong and they're choking you, what do you want to do for your life?
Right.
You don't care who it is. If it was God and he was pressing playing on you, you're going to resist a little bit. You know, so people need to realize there's no justification for this excessive brutality.
Not at all.
Period.
Like 14 years. We also have our Chief Inspector Patterson came yesterday, Captain Kendrew, and also Captain Zay, also reborn. Thank you all for coming. My name is Captain Kendrew, I'm the Captain of 14 District.
Together to press for justice for Tyree Carroll.
We have demanded, among other things, the immediate release of Tyree from jail, independent medical attention for Tyree and his traumatized family, putting the officers involved in administrative leave and ultimately fire, an investigation by the Department of Justice, and a meeting with the Justice for Tyree campaign. I heard one of the officers talking about bullying and teaching children about bullying. I assume you have seen the video of the assault by numerous officers of a man, 22-year-old unarmed man, on the ground, already restrained, being kicked, punched, cursed at with the worst obscenities. And we would like to know when the names of the officers who were involved will be released. And we would also like to know if they have been involved in other conduct like this and have complaints against them. There are members of Tyree's family here. This is his grandmother, Nancy Carroll, and his sister, Evan Carroll. They're here as well. So I would like to
want to know what's going to be did to the officer that beat my grandson like that. He was on the bike, he ran the car into the back and knocked him off the bike and got out and started eating. He wasn't doing anything right by the bike. He had just left my house. And I think it's totally wrong for somebody supposed to be protecting other people to do that to a human being. They supposed to be looking out for the human being, and in fact, they trying to kill them. And that's wrong. And I like to know what's going to take place.
I don't know if you want me to answer the questions that the professor asked me first, or answer your question first.
Whatever suits you best.
Okay. Ma'am, right now there is an internal affairs investigation going on. I'm sure that that part you are aware of. Internal affairs, of course, has as much of the video as was seen on the, YouTube, and as much as it was released or was provided to them. And they are investigating the actions of the officers, but all collectively, but also individually as well. But because there is an internal investigation going on right now, I can't answer the very specific question, more so that you raised, ma'am, with all due respect. But I can't answer those specific questions because it may compromise what the investigation that is in fact going on. What I can assure you, ma'am, is that investigation will be thorough. And like I said before, it will be the actions not only in tandem, in whole, will be assessed, but also the individual officers. So while I can't release the names right now, what I can assure you is that each officer's actions will be assessed and determinations will be made on their duty status. And also, let me just add this really quickly. In the embryonic stage of the investigation, as soon as the immediate facts are gathered, as much as can be ascertained on the front end, those facts are relayed to the district attorney's office. They get continuously updated so that they can make the decisions on charges should they be deemed appropriate. That's who would make the decision, to answer that one question you did ask. That's who would make the decision on whether the officer would be arrested. In terms of internally, any internal remedy, that decision will be made pursuant to that investigation. The pace at which it's going, I know would be is going as fast as it could go while also being thorough. I think we'd agree that you wouldn't want a hasty investigation one way or the other. And so they will be working as hard and as fast, but as thorough as they can be at the same time. Once one of those things happen, either a charging decision by the district attorney's office or a decision to, by the police commissioner to take, action that's under his authority, which would more often than not be after the investigation is completed, or to remove them from the street or what have you, those things will unfold. But it is being worked on, and it's not forgotten, it's not dismissed, it's not by the wayside or anything like that.
What about the release of the names of the officers who are
involved? No, that I can't do. That would have to be done if the decision was made by the department. It would be done by someone with the authority and approval of Commissioner Ramsey. Probably public affairs, media relations. That would be the component that would probably literally do it, but it would have to be with the authority of our police commissioner.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm Phoebe Jones. I'm with the Crossroads Women's Center here in Germantown.
Good evening.
Good evening. where Nancy Carroll and I have worked together since 2001. I've known Tyree Carroll since he was a youngster. You know, I've known him to be a very helpful person to his grandmother, helpful to us at the Women's Center. And we feel like that you've really dehumanized this person who is now, you know, he's taking, I visited him in prison. I'm a member of the Pennsylvania Prison Society and also a Quaker, a member of the Germantown Friends meeting. And I was able to visit him, you know, and we were very worried about his health in prison. He was not getting the medical attention. He has asthma. He had shooting pains coming up his leg from being stomped on, his foot being stomped on. And, you know, he's in there unjustly. He didn't do anything violent, yet the people that got caught on video doing violence are out roaming the streets. And we want them taken off administrative, put on administrative leave immediately.
Yes.
So that they're not out there endangering other young men. And one of the things, or anybody, and one of the things that Tyree told me, he said, let this stop with me. I don't
yes.
want this to happen to anybody else. And that as mothers and grandmothers and sisters at the Women's Center, we don't want this to happen to anybody's child. Black, Native American, Latino,
yes.
lesbian, gay, trans, white, you know, anybody, Asian. We do not want this happening to our children. And we feel that if that video had not been released, there would not have been an investigation
Absolutely.
At all. And it wasn't until we saw it, we put pressure on it, that anything is being done about it. That if it's not caught on video, you were talking about protecting your cell phones. Well, you know, the cell phones protect us. You know, because we can capture things that go on there. So we have some demands that we would like to put, to pass out, to have the, and have that, you know, done. But we also do not buy at all that his head, that he beat his head against the police van. We heard that in all these other cases, and they've been completely debunked, and you know, it's not true in this case either. And we want some action soon. We don't want the investigation to drag on. It's already been 3 months. It happened in April.
How do you beat a person like this? I wouldn't beat an animal like this, let alone a person. He was already on the ground. The video clearly shows he's on the ground, and cops is running up, kicking him, talking about, take the motherfucker like no one ever should be beat. He wasn't running. He didn't kill anybody. Like, there's no justice. Like, where's the justice for my future? Like, every time I think about my brother, every time I watch the video, it brings tears to my eyes and my heart aches. I was laying in my bed and thought I heard someone yelling. I muted my TV and I couldn't hear. Next thing I know, someone's knocking on my door telling me a gang of cops beat him, and that's exactly what it was, a gang. A gang.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
It's unjustified. Like I said, I would never beat an animal, let alone a human being like that. Like, where's the justice? Y'all want to say he supposedly had drugs on him. Let me say this. If he even did, do they justify?
Not at all.
He got
Not at all.
Nothing. But cops is going to cover their behind. Any means necessary to do what they do. You know, so many black youth out here that scared to come to cops because they see what's going on. Every time I turn my TV on, I'm seeing a cop that then killed someone or then beat someone. I have a daughter. When I grew up, I was told you go to the cops, they protect themselves. Nowadays, I tell my daughter, don't even go to the cops because I don't know who's good and who's
bad. That's right.
Like, it's unjust. My brother's in jail, in pain, and he's getting no medical attention. And like she said, you're talking about cell phone. If them neighbors never did that, nobody would never know anything. He would have just been in jail, this would have been in charges, this would have been a sentence, and that's it.
You know, we all saw the video, and what I'm wondering is if those of you who are sitting in the room with us who have uniforms on, who saw what happened in Ferguson, who saw what happened in New York, who were like, God, I hope either that doesn't happen or we don't know that it happened, you know, we don't want that to happen at home, and here it is. And we see it happening at home. We saw it with Tyree. What I think would mean something to me, and maybe it would mean something to the community, would be if there was some showing of, like, what we saw on that video is not what we're going to do. What we saw in that video is not what we
yes,
do.
It's yes.
not human. It is not the way this police district, you can't speak for the police force, it is not the way we're going to conduct matters. And maybe you don't know all the details, but we know that a couple of dozen people in uniform who were your comrades did something that to everybody in the room, and I just assume it includes all of you in uniform, was not okay, not humane, and not what we're going to have again. So I know you can't say anything, but...
That our policy is broken, when the law is violated, it troubles us, it bothers us, we don't like it, we don't want it. If you're asking, again, though, about the specifics of that case, I can't really comment on that because the investigation's going on. But yes, man, when crimes are committed, whether they're by the police or anyone else, we don't like it. When atrocities happen, we don't like it. When our internal policies and operating procedures are violated, we don't like it. I hear on both sides, Commissioner Ramsey is praised on one end because he's fired more police officers than they needed. They needed to be. The ones that did, he has taken the action he needs to take. But then on the other side, there's also the perception, true or not, but there is a perception that there is no accountability. I think somewhere it's in the middle, but. We do have a commissioner now that does say, these are our policies.
Just to be clear, I wasn't asking about overall accountability, like if those people...
But that's unfortunately today.
Just to clarify,
yeah.
I wasn't asking whether those people... There was a question that I think it's a good and important one, which you can't answer, about what's going to happen to those officers, and that's not what I'm asking. What I'm asking is for you to join everybody else who sees the inhumane thing that happened.
Yes.
And to say, that is not okay.
Yes.
I'm sorry, because that's not what we... officers intend to be, because you don't have to be the judiciary or anybody to see the video and to know that that's not the way that our police district, it's not okay.
And again, with all due respect, and I'm not trying to avoid your question, but I can't opine on that particular case right now. I know that's not satisfactory to you, and I respect that, but I can't. I'm just not permitted to make an opinion.
I've been in the town of Appear since 1987. And I understand, I guess, it's not great. I know you're kind of caught in a place where you can't respond to that, but maybe this is something someone here, I actually wish the commissioner were here right now, because I've watched these horror stories of what's happened in these other cities. It leaves me speechless. So when I saw this video and saw what happened right here, I had to be here at this meeting. I apologize to everybody back here that I was late, but I had to be here. Some years ago, my son did something really stupid. He was a high school student following his soccer team to a match. He was driving my car behind them. He had a toy cap gun, very realistic cap gun. He was shooting, playing games at his teammates on the bus, driving through Kensington. The bus pulled away because a pedestrian noticed it. Bus pulled away, and my car, my son, my younger son, was surrounded by not one, but seven police cars and FBI cars and men jumping out with their guns drawn. And I know to the bottom of my soul that the only reason my son is still alive today, the only reason those men had restraint enough not to pull those triggers, was because he's white.
Right.
Sadly, our nation's history shows that if he had been black, I would have been at a funeral instead of looking forward now to his wedding. And what happened to this young man on the bicycle is unfathomable. So my question, you can't comment on that. My question to you, to the commissioner, if he was here, what is the Philadelphia Police Force going to do in terms of training, of sensitization,
yes.
what it takes? What is the police force doing now
Mm-hmm.
And what were you going to do to try to work with people and their attitudes and their reflexes and their unthinking biases that are underlying this kind of horror? What are we doing to try to change the course and not have this stuff happen again?
And I can answer that. You know, just explaining, I know that.
I think what we need to do is continue the pressure on for full prosecution extent of all these officers that are involved. And it's quite clear on the video, I think, although everybody's seen it nationwide and worldwide for that matter. So I just want to make that point. That's what my campaign's going to do.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Hi, my name is Yane, and I live at who had a definite, absolute real gun and was surrounded by police officers who spent so much time talking that man down because they knew that his life mattered and they did not want to take his life, even though they knew for sure that he had a real gun and was pointing at a whole bunch of people. But this little boy, who was so young, even if he did have a real gun, there was no effort and attempt to save his life. That's the reason why people are reiterating what we should all know, which is that Black Lives Matter. But to your point, I want to share a story that was shared with me. And I didn't remember the person who told me this story. But he was telling me about he lived in a housing development in New York. And when he was a young child, he watched a police officer run through the development chasing after someone. That officer shot at that person and missed and ended up shooting a kid in that was playing outside. And the officer stopped his pursuit and ran to that child and held that child. And the family was contacted. They came out. They were told what happened. And the man, the officer, was crying, trying to resuscitate the child. And the whole community came around them. And they prayed for both the family and that officer. Because in that moment, that officer was human. And he was recognizing that he had affected other human beings. There's a forgetting. Like, I understand you guys are in your uniforms and you have a job, but the first thing that you are is human.
Yes.
And the first thing that you have
yes.
is your humanity. And if you are walking with another officer, I mean, everybody has bad days. I have bad days like every day right now. And the reason I have bad days every day, like literally, I cry almost every day is because of all of this. I can't even turn on my computer. I have had to shut down my Facebook. I can't connect because I keep getting inundated with all of this that's happening. I'm snapping on people left and right. I've always been like a peaceful, loving, and kind and caring person. And I've been so slow to anger, but I snap on people every day. I'm snapping on a man because he didn't take the time to move his car over and he's double parked and he's blocking me. I'm getting out of my car and starting arguments with this man because of the emotional distress that I'm experiencing because of what's happening to people, and I care about that. And what's hard, on top of the fact that this is happening, is that you all are human beings who are not stepping out and saying that you also care that this is happening and that it hurts you to see people being harmed and hurt and treated badly by anyone, whether they are officers or they're your fellow officers or it's your partner or not. And that's what I feel is missing, is that willingness to stand up beyond your uniforms and say what we all know and understand to be true, which is that this is not right and that it hurts you too. I need there to be connection. We can't be separate and make this work.
That's right.
It has to be connection.
That's right.
It has to be a movement beyond the officer-civilian space.
Yes.
And the uniform
yes.
and ununiformed space. There has to be. Every single person who has been harmed knows, probably has a family member or a neighbor who is a police officer. We're not separate. We're not different. My aunt's an officer.
Mm-hmm.
My cousin is applying right now, having retired from the Army, is applying right now to become a police officer. The police are our family members and our neighbors.
Yes.
And yet, they're silent when our community members are being harmed and they're not stepping out. And I just don't understand how you have 16 people and no one amongst those people in that moment is saying, slow down.
Right.
What are you doing?
Right.
Stop that. That's a person.
Right.
That's a human being. Love is only first. So that is what I need for you guys. Please, to stop each other. I know there's that whole blue line, whatever, blue shield, whatever it is, but in that space, you have to be stopping each other. You have to be saying, yo, man, you're having a bad day.
That's right.
You're going a little far. You're going a little extreme. Pull back. Let me handle this because you're going too far. Police each other better so we don't have to be in these meetings having these conversations. Please. Thank you.
I also live in the Unarmed area of this neighborhood. I've lived in the community since 1995. I have a son who's black. And so with this incident, and I know Tyree as well, and I work with Ms. Carroll in the Toronto Police Center, and I know you know Tyree since he was a child. He and my son went to Chuck E. Cheese together, birthday party and so on. And then not only so intolerable, and that it's also scary for me as his mother of a black child, especially because he's black, and not just for black children, of course. But that, and also I have, in our community, we've been talking about how to make things safer. And so that there's been discussion, well, maybe we need more police. And then when you see this kind of thing happen, boy, we sure don't want more police.
Right.
And also, there are other parents in my community who also have expressed their fears, like a mother who has a child who is in the autistic spectrum. And how somebody who may not know how to respond in a way that an officer may perceive as a threat. There's all kinds of ways that we are terrified for our children, and we want some accountability here. I haven't heard anything yet that if you all saw that video, how could you sit there like that and not have any kind of determination for accountability and not have this thing happen ever again?
On this course, everything Captain Kennedy has told you, that is the process that we're going through, you know, and when internal affairs come out, the decision on it, or the police commissioner will come in, we'll be handled accordingly. But for us to sit here and comment, make statements about what's right, what's wrong, we're not going to do that here in this forum. The investigation is going, but we will not compromise the investigation, the integrity of that investigation. It has to run its course. And as Captain Kennebrew said, and I reiterate, we're going to be redundant. Our people, they're going to do a good job. Internal affairs are going to do what they do. They're going to do a thorough investigation of it. The DA's office will play their part in it.
Do you believe it was good policing? Like the police, you said good policing. Do you believe it was good policing?
Everything within. See, one thing about the videos, you see one facet, and this is one of the things that's probably going on now. It's always what you did. The same thing with the cameras, the new cameras out, you know, with the body cameras that the officers wearing in the holiday show. You know. So, investigations, of course, going in.
I think it's good policing. That's you, Mr. Patterson. If you
Chief Inspector
Patterson. Chief Inspector Patterson. Do you agree that it was good policing?
When all facts and circumstances come out regarding that determination of the investigation, then that's where we go. I'm not sitting here offering my opinion based on what has been viewed on that video at this point. And the investigation is ongoing. Questions will be answered. Your questions will be answered down the line.
It's been a lot going on. And the big problem with the police department is we are asking, as the community, for internal affairs, who are also police, to investigate themselves.
Yes.
Around the country, you guys have been listening, there's a lot been going on. A lot of police departments have chosen to go with an independent agency to investigate police.
Yeah.
It is much quicker. But asking police to investigate themselves, it takes time. It shouldn't, because if it was me and 20 of my guys beating the guy, we'll be in jail and everything would go through within a year. But listen, you guys have to understand, it goes far beyond them. It goes into voting. When we vote people in office, we even vote people who care about the things that we care about. That it should be an independent agency investigating police brutality. The internal affairs should never, ever be part of the police department. And that's where the issue lies, in my opinion.
And I agree.
A couple of more back here, sir.
Two things. Number one, I think the lawyers in the room ought to make it clear to the family how the process works. Because these people can say something to jeopardize the whole case, and they know that. And the lawyers should tell the family how it works so they don't feel that they are being left out. There is a system. And the family needs to understand it. My other thing is, would you raise your hand if you've been to one of the last three meetings of this type? Raise your hand if you've been to one of these meetings before. You see, we need to come to these meetings every month, not when something personally happens, not when we have a camera, so that we can get stuff worked out. But we don't come to a crisis here.
Yes, sir. I'm going to make this the last question, unless the family has something else. I'm going to make this the last question, because we don't want to leave.
Yes, I'm going to ask the elephant in the room. We're saying to you, the community is saying to you, that if you want to answer for what riding a bike down Walmart Street. She caused an incident like this to happen, or perhaps it didn't happen, or it didn't happen. What were those people thinking about? Secondly, there was a case recently whereby six guys that were formerly with Shields were convicted in court just recently. Ramsey had fired them. Guess what happened after the federal court? The arbitrators come in. Who the hell are these arbitrators? One is by the police department or city, one is independent, and one is FOP. Even in the decision, look, these five guys want the job back, and you, taxpayers, going to pay them $60,000 back pay. So what fans can do? You can put on a detail, try to keep them out of whatever site, so to speak, hope you resign again. But it's an epidemic going on, not just here, but all over the country. But in the community, in each community, we have responsibility too. We have a crime wave coming that's not in blue. It is, folks, every day I pick up the paper, every night, there's how many murders in certain areas of the city? Dangerous out there. So what do you think? You think the guys in blue don't feel that danger? But then the bottom line is, how do you really separate the bad guys from the good guys? Because we know they are good guys. I see them patrolling my area all the time. But I rarely see them stop, get the car, every one time on the patrol. So say something to you. Hey, how you doing? What's going on? No, you want to ride. You come in here to make a report, you stand at that desk on my own. Waiting for somebody to recognize, get up, so I'll be right there, sir. What's that all about? We're all the citizens. We all have responsibilities, the same as you. But the other elephant in the room that's not here tonight, as far as I know, is Seth Williams. Who is he? Who is Seth Williams? Anybody know?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
My issue is this. Like you said, you guys are going to take and sort through the way you guys see fit. If it had been one of us that committed this crime, we're automatically guilty until we're proven innocent. Like, that's just the way it is. So, you know, it's like, it's a double standard, which is totally unfair. My daughter's father, she's 22 now. In 1997, he was paralyzed by the police. In a paddy wagon, he hit the top of his head. Do you know why? Because him and the police officer had angry words. And he was in a paddy wagon, and they did the whole racing down the street and stopping, and racing down the street and stopping. Hit the top of his head. He was 23 years old. He never walked again. That's his daughter, and that's his granddaughter sitting right here. What you guys do, and I'm not just saying you, I'm saying you boys in blue, because y'all all stick together. It's like we're fighting against y'all, and y'all supposed to be here to protect us. We can't rely on you. I would never call 911, not unless it was for an ambulance. I would never, ever, because when you call the police, it always escalates into something else. I don't trust you. I can't stand you, to be perfectly honest. And I have every reason to feel like this. I have a father in prison doing a life sentence. He's done 31 years of his life sentence for something that he did not even do. So, you know, I really have a whole bunch of anger against you. And I'm not the only one. It's so many black men out here with anger against you. And this is the reason that so many things are done. You know, y'all grabbed him. Y'all had him on the ground. You tased him. For what? You already had his arms behind his back. What are you tasing him for? He was already restrained. You said he bit one of y'all. If y'all choking him, your arm is around his neck. It's human nature to bite. Who wouldn't protect themselves? Who wouldn't? You know, you treat us the way that you're supposed to want for your brother and your sister what you want for yourself. You wouldn't want your brother or sister to be treated that way. You treat us like dogs. If you lock a dog in a cage and feed them periodically, when they get out, the first thing they're going to do is bite you. So what do you think about us? You know, you lock us in the cage. You don't even you don't even thoroughly investigate things. The whole point is for you to just make an arrest. That's the whole thing. You know, we're wrongly convicted all the time. We're beaten, we're shot. This, and it's not new. It's been going on for years and years and years. It's nothing but modern day slavery. And I'm not even gonna just say that it happens with blacks, because there's a sprinkle of whites that, you know, they get the business sometimes too. But y'all giving us the business all the time, all the time. And it's not fair. It's really not fair. And then y'all stand there with the snide remarks. Y'all, I've personally seen not even just police officers, but correctional officers. Y'all all have this air about you, like this supreme air about you, like you're better than someone. You look down on us, like we're not your equal. I'm your equal. I pay taxes.
That's right. That's right.
I work every single day. You hear me? Every day. And what I do, I'm a medical assistant. What I do, I save lives too. I protect too. So I deserve the same respect. My family deserves the same respect that you guys do. And it's time for us to start demanding it. Instead of asking for it, like he said, this meeting is every month and we all should be here every single month.
Yeah.
Every single month.
Right.
I don't care what you, if you gotta be late, if you get here at 6:45, we need to be here. Because y'all need to know that we matter. Thank you.
I'm finding so many different mentalities. It seems challenging. I won't say hard because the only thing hard is the concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge. And I was built for this. I think that we all have a purpose in life, and mine's going to take on a task that most will back away from. That impossible, some people say is impossible. I see possibilities. I don't see anything as being impossible. Mentalities, there are different mentalities, but just like there's different ways to teach people how to read, there's different ways to communicate people, there's different ways to communicate people and their different mentalities. So I do see hope, and I see hope in us all coming together and understanding each other and learning to respect.